Take a look at the cloudless night sky. With the moon shining and a multitude of stars and galaxies in the backdrop, a whole new mysterious world unfolds before us. All these celestial wonders descend at one place in Bangalore, the Planetarium, Jawaharlal Nehru Planetarium, established by the erstwhile Bangalore City Corporation. Planetarium is the Sky Theater, with a centrally placed special projector that you see here. The night sky is simulated on the hemispherical dome above us. The planetarium produces several audio-visual programs. Special projectors beam colorful pictures, cartoons, computer animations and graphics, and special mechanical effects that enliven the presentation. Mirror Dome, the new technology that adds a new dimension to one's experience in the planetarium show, provides an immersive feeling. A sense of being part of the scene itself. Truly, a one-of-its-kind experience. The planetarium show is preceded by Science Watch.
This is Science Watch, a preview of some of the recent developments in fields of science and technology.
Neighboring the Sky Theater is the Exhibition Hall. The exhibits supplement the main program with additional scientific content for the discerning visitor. Our solar system in the artist's imagination. Weigh yourself on various planets by merely standing on this weighing scale. Located in the Planetarium campus is the Science Park. Simple participatory exhibits provide education with amusement. Here, science can be experienced firsthand. Stars is a monthly program that introduces one to the night sky and celestial events of the month. The positions of stars, planets and constellations for the month are familiarized under the simulated night sky inside the Sky Theater. This is exactly how one would see in the natural sky outside. Some of the celestial objects are shown through telescopes. Celestial events such as solar and lunar eclipses, transit of Venus and occasional comets cause much excitement to the public. The Jawaharlal Nehru Planetarium makes elaborate arrangements to watch them safely. The planetarium produces exhibits to educate the visitors on these events. These activities, while offering a relevant scientific explanation, quell misconceptions and superstition among the public. Science in action. Exciting experiments and working models explain the scientific principles in a lucid manner. Teachers find several of these experiments useful for classroom teaching from primary to undergraduate classes. Exhibition on various topics are also held here. Movies on scientific topics are usually screened on the third Sunday of the month. Popular documentaries such as Cosmos by Carl Sagan, Ascent of Man by Jacob Bronowski, and Blue Planet by David Attenborough are shown. The program has shown a steady growth in its popularity. Universe in the Classroom. In this workshop, children and adults are introduced to observing the sky through naked eye, binoculars, and simple telescopes. The telescope that you see here is a high-quality optical telescope manufactured by Carl Zeiss. During the daytime, one can safely study the sunspots and spectrum of sunlight. Beautiful rings of Saturn, satellites of Jupiter, and a host of other celestial objects can be viewed and studied at night. Workshops for content enrichment and practice of effective methodologies in teaching of science and mathematics are regularly conducted for school teachers. Summer programs for children, hands-on experiments, lectures by subject experts, visits to premier research institutes infuse interest and motivation to do science among children. SEED, or Science Education in Early Development, is a program for kids to learn science and mathematics through recreational activities involving toys and games. Base Camp is a 10-day experiential program for primary and high school children using science kits to make them feel science. Summer Course is a 15-day thematic interdisciplinary course for high school children involving lectures, discussions, experiments, and field trips. From the Web of Life to the Universe, a series of lectures introducing frontier areas of research to college students. Interactive sessions for high school students are held on Sundays. The students perform experiments, solve problems, and discuss concepts, all of which help in developing a lasting interest in doing science. REAP, or Research Education Advancement Program, is a 3-year rigorous course for undergraduate or postgraduate students with an aptitude for research and teaching. The program is actively supported by premier institutes such as the Indian Institute of Science, the Raman Research Institute, and the Indian Institute of Astrophysics. Lectures by reputed scientists, exploring through experiments. Creative projects that challenge the brilliant minds, transform students into scientists. Scientists provide opportunities for REAP students to work with them and experience research environment. A similar program entitled BioREAP has begun for students of life sciences. The programs conducted over the weekends lay a strong foundation in the basics and develop problem-solving skills, which are essential for a researcher. Students experience the joy of doing research. REAP students are pursuing PhD programs at various top universities in India and abroad, a clear indication of the impact of this program. In addition to their routine programs, the planetarium plays host to several reputed scientists from outside India to deliver popular and academic lectures. Please do visit the planetarium. Enjoy the cool environs of the Sky Theater. As the lights dim and you look at the sky dome, become one with the vast universe.
ತಲೆಯೆತ್ತಿ ಆಕಾಶದಲ್ಲೊಮ್ಮೆ ಇಣುಕಿ ನೋಡಿ, ಇರುಳಿನಲ್ಲಿ ಕಂಗೊಳಿಸುವ ಚಂದ್ರ, ಹಿನ್ನೆಲೆಯಲ್ಲಿ ಅಸಂಖ್ಯಾತ ನಕ್ಷತ್ರಗಳು, ಗ್ಯಾಲಕ್ಸಿಗಳು, ಒಂದು ವಿಸ್ಮಯಕಾರಿ ರಮಣೀಯ ಲೋಕವೇ ನಮ್ಮೆದುರು ತೆರೆದುಕೊಳ್ಳುತ್ತದೆ. ಆಗಸದ ಇಂಥ ಅದ್ಭುತ ರಮ್ಯಗಳನ್ನು ಧರೆಗೇ ಇಳಿಸಿ ದರ್ಶಿಸುವ ತಾಣವೊಂದಿದೆ ಬೆಂಗಳೂರಿನಲ್ಲಿ, ತಾರಾಲಯ, ಜವಾಹರ್ಲಾಲ್ ನೆಹರು ತಾರಾಲಯ. ಬೆಂಗಳೂರು ಮಹಾನಗರ ಪಾಲಿಕೆ 1989ರಲ್ಲಿಯೇ ಸ್ಥಾಪಿಸಿದ ಈ ತಾರಾಲಯಕ್ಕೆ ಲಕ್ಷಾಂತರ ಜನ ಭೇಟಿ ನೀಡಿದ್ದಾರೆ. ಶ್ರೇಷ್ಠ ವಿಜ್ಞಾನಿಗಳ ನೇತೃತ್ವದಲ್ಲಿ ಕರ್ನಾಟಕ ಸರ್ಕಾರ 1992ರಲ್ಲಿ ಸ್ಥಾಪಿಸಿದ ಬೆಂಗಳೂರು ಅಸೋಸಿಯೇಷನ್ ಫಾರ್ ಸೈನ್ಸ್ ಎಜುಕೇಷನ್ ಒಂದು ಸ್ವಾಯತ್ತ ಸಂಸ್ಥೆ. ಈ ಆಡಳಿತ ಮಂಡಳಿಯ ಸಮರ್ಥ ನಿರ್ವಹಣೆಯಲ್ಲಿ ನಡೆಯುತ್ತಿರುವ ಜವಾಹರ್ಲಾಲ್ ನೆಹರು ತಾರಾಲಯದ ಮುಖ್ಯ ಉದ್ದೇಶಗಳು ವಿಜ್ಞಾನವನ್ನು ಜನಪ್ರಿಯಗೊಳಿಸುವುದು ಹಾಗೂ ಅನೌಪಚಾರಿಕ ವಿಧಾನಗಳ ಮೂಲಕ ವಿಜ್ಞಾನ ಶಿಕ್ಷಣವನ್ನು ನೀಡುವುದು. ಜವಾಹರ್ಲಾಲ್ ನೆಹರು ತಾರಾಲಯದ ಪ್ರಮುಖ ಆಕರ್ಷಣೆ ಈ ಸ್ಕೈ ಥಿಯೇಟರ್, ಆಕಾಶ ಮಂದಿರ. ಇದರ ಕೇಂದ್ರ ಬಿಂದುವಿನಲ್ಲಿ ಇರುವ ಈ ವಿಶಿಷ್ಟ ಪ್ರೊಜೆಕ್ಟರ್ ಸಹಾಯದಿಂದ ನಮ್ಮ ತಲೆಯ ಮೇಲೆ ಇರುವ ಅರ್ಧ ಗೋಳಾಕಾರದ ತೆರೆಯ ಮೇಲೆ ಈರುಳಿನ ಆಕಾಶವು ಪ್ರತ್ಯಕ್ಷವಾಗುತ್ತದೆ. ತಾರಾಲಯವು ಹಲವು ಧ್ವನಿ ದೃಶ್ಯ ಕಾರ್ಯಕ್ರಮಗಳನ್ನು ತಯಾರಿಸುತ್ತದೆ.
ನಿಮಗೆ ಮೆಸೇಜ್ ಬರುತ್ತಾ? Pleasure for me to welcome you all to this special lecture series. I also welcome the virtual audience who are watching us live on the webcast. This year 2015 marks the centenary of Albert Einstein's publication, The General Theory of Relativity. And we have here so many institutes and so many scientists who are working in this field. And I'm sure that many of these institutes will be celebrating this event all through the year. Keeping this in mind, we here at the Planetarium have decided to arrange a lecture series entitled Einstein and Relativity in these three coming months. We are very fortunate that we have the renowned astrophysicist Professor C.V. Vishveshwara here. He is also the founder director of this planetarium, and he has written several scripts for the planetarium programs, and he is very well known as a good orator as well as a good author. He has published a book, Einstein's Enigma, Odd Black Holes, a few years ago, and the more recent one is Universe Unveiled. Both the books have received very good compliments from stalwarts like Roger Penrose and similar dignitaries. He obtained his PhD working with the famous physicist Charles Messner at the University of Maryland, and he has been a visiting professor at various universities, and he also served as the senior professor at the Raman Research Institute and the Indian Institute of Astrophysics. So this he has edited several volumes on the black holes, and he has written many research papers also on the same subject. So now I request him to deliver this lecture, and this will be followed by question answers after the vote of thanks. Thank you all.
Thank you, sir. Dr. Shailaja for those very generous and warm words of introduction, and also for hosting these three lectures by me about the general theory of relativity. I would also like to thank my friend and colleague of the planetarium, H.R. Madhusudana, for helping me with the slides and putting together all the beautiful visuals on the slides you are going to see. And my colleagues of the planetarium who have made so many different arrangements. And finally, Mr. Lal of Video Hut has made such elaborate and fantastic arrangements with the video and also streaming and so on and so forth. I'm very grateful to all the people. Now, so we are going to talk about centenary celebration of general theory of relativity of Einstein, which he put forward in 1950. That is 100 years ago. It's the centenary year. And why are we celebrating this? It's because this theory, general theory of relativity, which is a theory of gravitation, is an unprecedented theory. There has never been a theory like that, and probably there won't be a theory like that in the future either. So the only way to describe that theory is by one word, unique. Because of the simplicity of the fundamental tenets of the theory, with no reference, hardly any reference to observational facts, and the logic and the mathematics, all these developments, and finally spectacular applications it has found in astrophysics and cosmology. Because of general theory of relativity, our perception, our view of the universe has completely changed. And in astrophysics, some of the things which had not even been imagined, like black holes, gravitational radiation, and these things have come to be known today. This is the reason we are today celebrating the centenary of general theory of relativity. And as you can see in the picture, in the slide here, it represents the space-time curvature, which was actually imagined and brought forward by Einstein's theory. And gravitation is actually identified with this space-time curvature. And this has led to cosmology, astrophysics, and so on. But on a very mundane scale, down to Earth, general relativistic corrections find a place in even modern technology like global positioning system or GPS. I do not know whether some of you have come here using GPS. If you have used it, and if there were no general relativistic corrections, probably you would have ended up not in the planetarium, but in maybe Hotel Ashoka. Maybe you would have been happier there, sipping something or the other, rather than listening to my dry talk. But you have no choice. You are here. And I'm going to start this talk not with the general theory of relativity, but after all, right in the beginning, there was special theory of relativity. That is the beginning. That is the alpha from which we will go on to general theory of relativity. So we have here Einstein and relativity and the special theory of relativity, which fused space and time, as we are going to see this. Now, relativity, the idea of relativity was not new. It did not arise simply from Einstein himself, but it dates back to the great scientist, astronomer, and even writer Galileo Galilei. You can see his picture. And as a matter of fact, Galileo thought of relativity. He did not give the name relativity. He realized that through any mechanical experiments or observations, you cannot distinguish between two observers who are moving with respect to each other with constant velocity. These are called inertial observers, moving with constant velocity. And as a matter of fact, in a charming letter, he wrote about what would happen if you are closeted in a chamber below the deck of a ship. So inside this chamber, you can do all sorts of things. You can have butterflies flying, fish swimming in a bowl, water drops falling from above, and the two friends throwing balls around and all that. Then, if the ship starts moving with constant velocity, you cannot know the difference between your state of rest and your state of motion with constant velocity. So he was aware of that. And as a matter of fact, after describing all this, he says, let me read. Now, once you have made all these observations and seen how these motions appear exactly the same when the ship moves as well as when it stands still, will you not abandon all the doubt that the same must happen in regard to the terrestrial globe? Now he is generalizing this to the earth itself. Add to this that for the case of the ship, we cannot determine from the things within it what it does, even though with ease we can make it move or make it stand still. How can it be possible to determine this for the earth, which in our experience has always been in the same state? So you see, he was trying to support the Copernican system in which the earth goes around the sun, and he was trying to tell that you cannot really know the difference between the earth that is standing still and going around the earth. That is how the Galilean relativity came into being. Essentially, you cannot find out whether you are moving or not. You cannot find out the relative motion, constant velocity by mechanical means. So this has come to be known as Galilean relativity or Galilean-Newtonian relativity, because it was Newton who really put all this into the mathematical frame. As you can see in the picture, the picture depicts all the great discoveries of Isaac Newton, like planets going around the sun, and on the other side, right hand side. Can the door be closed? We hear that sound coming from there. Can that be closed? So, and also the telescope and so on and so forth. And also the spectrum, all the great discoveries of Isaac Newton. So he put it into a mathematical framework, this relativity, which is known as the Galilean and the Newtonian relativity. And the idea is very simple. The idea is like this. You have two observers, O, who is at rest, who is standstill, and the other one, O prime, who is moving with a constant velocity, V. So what do you see with respect to each other? If you have, say Mysore, 144 kilometers from Bangalore, so somebody sitting here, that's the distance he will measure. But on the other hand, if you are driving towards Mysore with the constant velocity V, probably it's impossible with all the curves and so on, but if you manage or imagine that, the distance that will be to the destination will be the distance x minus the distance you have traveled, which is v times t. That is the first one. X prime equals x minus vt. This is supposed to be a non-technical. This is not very technical, right? So, if you don't want to read the equations, that's perfectly all right, because I'm going to explain what it is. So, x prime equals x minus vt, the distance measured by the moving observer. As you can see, this space x, I mean, space means space is defined by the measurement of distances, that x is mixed with the t. Therefore, time and space are mixed in that first equation. And let us remember that. But very important thing is that the time measured by the moving observer is supposed to be exactly the same as the time measured by the one that is moving and the one who is at standing still. Both measure the same time. This is an extremely important Galilean-Newtonian assumption, and I can tell you already that with Einstein that changed, and that was a revolutionary change that came into being. But this is very important assumption for Newton and Galileo. And of course, y primed and z primed are the same as y and z, and that won't change. This is the Newtonian and Galilean relativity, and everything was fine. These glitches happen, otherwise life will not be exciting. So, this is where it stood. But then came two people who brought in electromagnetism. These were the people, Faraday, Michael Faraday, first of all. You know, Michael Faraday had no schooling, hardly any schooling. He was an apprentice to a bookbinder, and he went to listen to the Christmas lectures at the Royal Institution. The president was, the director was Humphrey Davy of the Davy Lamp. And so what he did was, he took beautiful notes, bound it and sent it as a present to Davy, and Davy immediately employed him as a janitor, sweeping and all that. That was the only job that was available. But then Faraday became a scientist and took over as the director after Davy, and he made fantastic experiments. Most skillful experimenter, one of the most skillful experimenters. So even if you don't have high school or any education, there is still hope. But you do study. I mean, don't drop out. So he was the one. And once again, the mathematical framework was provided by Maxwell, who was a professor. And he gave four equations, Maxwell's equations, that codified completely the entire electromagnetic theory. Now, four equations, that's all. Now remember, Newton gave three equations of motion. One, gravitational, the universal law of gravitation. Once again, four equations, which completely explained everything that was known in his time, like motion of the planets and the comets and so on and so forth. So, four equations are very important there and here. And this was the birth of the electromagnetic theory. And Einstein had something wonderful to say about the two. Let me try to find that and read. The Faraday-Maxwell pair has a most remarkable inner similarity with the pair Galileo-Newton. The former of each pair grasping the relations intuitively, and the second one formulating these relations exactly and applying them quantitatively. So, one giant extolling four other giants. So, and all the scientists I am going to refer are great scientists. So I don't want to say great, great, great. I am not going to talk about scientists, but only great scientists. So I won't repeat that. So with the electromagnetic theory, there were problems. Of course, it explained everything about electricity and magnetism, but also there were some problems, and I won't have problem showing you this. Can I do this? He says, okay. Now you see what is going to happen is, this is electromagnetic induction, which was actually demonstrated by Faraday himself. Not with this kind of thing, but this is more sophisticated than here. So the idea is, if you thrust a magnet into a coil, there will be a current. On the other hand, if you hold the magnet steady and push the coil, there will also be exactly the same kind of current. We are going to show this. In the first one, there is no, what happened? As you can see, there is no relative motion, there is no current, okay? Now what he is going to do is, drop a magnet through the coil and there will be a current. Watch. Will it work or not? Did you see that? Should I do it again? How do I do it again? Go back. Now, watch. Oh, it went back. So things don't work all that well. So what's going to happen now? Let's see. No? Okay. Imagine that it fell and there was a current. Alright? Einstein said, knowledge is more important than... No, I'm sorry. Imagination is more important than knowledge. That is knowledge, but you have imagination. Okay, next one, shall we see whether it works? No? What's happening, Asgarani? Okay, next one. The coil will be moved up. Alright. So, there is an asymmetry according to the interpretation. Although the both are relative, the motion is relative, the interpretation was, when you have a moving magnet, an electric field is produced which generates the current. But on the other hand, if the magnet is static and the coil is moved, it was assumed or proposed that an electromotive force will be produced, and that will generate the current. So the two interpretations were totally different, but after all it's only relative motion. And so this had to be remedied. That's one thing. And the next thing, most important, is the electromagnetic radiation like light, infrared, X-ray, and all those things you know. That is composed of electric field which will be oscillating and a magnetic field which will be oscillating. The whole thing will be moving, and that's the wave motion for electromagnets. Now, other kind of waves were also known. For example, if you have a ripple, then the water molecules move and the ripple moves on. And in the case of sound, air molecules move, and through the air, the sound waves go on, move. Therefore, it was assumed that there should be a medium even for the electromagnetic waves, and that was called ether. This ether, very elusive jelly-like thing, which was transparent, permeated everything in the universe, and The idea was, how do you detect this ether through which electromagnetic wave is supposed to travel? Once again, like relativity, ether was not a newcomer to physics. Even in the time of Isaac Newton, he talked about ether, and not only that, he thought comets, that's a very favorite subject of our director, Dr. B.S. Shailaja. The comets are supposed to be concentrations of ether. Not only that, if comets falling into the sun actually produce the energy of the sun. All these things have changed, so they look funny, but on the other hand, that's what Newton said. So, ether was proposed, and also ether wind. So, if you are going in a train and you hold your hand outside, nowadays with the air conditioning, the windows cannot be opened. In our childhood, we used to do that. And you see the wind going. So, if you are moving, there should be a ether wind. And if the light is moving along the ether wind, the velocity of light will be c plus v, v being your own velocity, which is the velocity of the ether wind also. Now, on the other hand, if you are going opposite to that, then it will be c minus v, and that should tell you that there is an ether wind. But on the other hand, if we measure the light velocity perpendicular to your motion, it will remain the same. So, idea is very simple. You measure the velocity of light along the direction of the earth, because then the ether wind will change the velocity of the light, and you measure perpendicular to that when it is not changed. When you compare, you should know the presence of ether, and this was done by two people, Michelson and Morley. So, this is a very sophisticated, very delicate experiment. I don't want to go into the details, you can read it in a textbook. So, there are interferometers, light being reflected, and then you see the interference fringes, and as you can see in the right hand picture, if it is moving along Earth is moving, and you measure the velocity of light in that direction, you will see the ether wind, and perpendicular to that, you won't see, we compare that, and you will detect ether. Now, Michelson and Morley did this, and they did not find any ether. The experiment was null, and Michelson himself said that there was no evidence for the existence of ether. This is where things stood before Einstein made his appearance, but we will track back a little bit. Of course, even before Michelson-Morley experiment came into being, people think that Einstein was not even aware of Michelson-Morley experiment when he gave his theory of relativity. In any case, let us track back and go to Einstein, and I will have to excuse myself and so we track back. And this is Einstein when he was a student at the age of 16 or 17. You can see his moustache sprouting at the age of 17. It became very big later on, as you know. And the hair is nicely combed, not unkempt. And then he says that at that age he thought of a paradox. Here is the paradox. I hope you can read it, but I will read it for you. After 10 years of reflection, such a principle, that's principle of relativity, resulted from a paradox upon which I had already hit at the age of 16. If I pursue a beam of light with the velocity of light in a vacuum, I should observe such a beam of light as an electromagnetic field at rest, though spatially oscillating. From the very beginning, it appeared to me intuitively clear that, judged from the standpoint of such an observer, everything would have to happen according to the same laws as for an observer who, relative to Earth, was at rest. So what is the paradox here? See, the waves would be going like that. The electric field will be oscillating, so will be the magnetic fields, and the whole wave will be moving. But if you are following the wave with the same speed, what will you see? The electric fields will be static, fixed at one point. Similarly, the magnetic field, but they will be oscillating at the same point, back and forth. But what's the paradox? Such a solution is not admitted by Maxwell's equation. So it cannot exist. And similarly, he says, the observation should be the same as would be done by any observer who is at rest. But if you are moving with velocity of light, you won't observe the same thing, because the light will be going, you will be going, many of the things you may not even see. This is called Einstein mirror. He is going there and the mirror is there on the right. He is also moving. Therefore, the light from his face won't even hit the mirror. So how will he shave? He is trying to shave there. So that's why he didn't have a beard, or he didn't shave the mustache, but he definitely shaved off his beard, if there was one. So this cannot happen. So this is also part of the paradox. This is only an amusing example. So how do you get rid of the paradox? The only way to get rid of the paradox is to say that no observer can move with the speed of light. And that came about only with the advent of theory of relativity. So we come now to finally to theory of relativity. So that in space, we are at the patent office in Bern on the left, and you can see inside the patent office, those are the officers in the patent office, and Einstein, who was technical expert class 3. That was his job. Why was he in the patent office? Because even after his doctoral degree, he could not get a job. That's a very familiar story even today. By the way, I was unemployed for 3 months. Got a job later on, fortunately, so I am here. I didn't get the job here, but somewhere else. So he didn't have a job. So through the good offices of his former classmate, Marshall Grossman, his father's good officers, he got this job. So in the patent office, as you can see, Einstein is not there. But as you can see, all of them have big mustaches. So probably in those days, all Germans had mustaches, with the possible exception of women and children. We don't know about that also. Okay, so he was in the patent office. This is Einstein at the age of 26 in the patent office. And in the patent office, he had a wonderful colleague and friend, my name Michele Besso, who was an Italian. And Einstein could talk to him. And he would go to Besso's house, and his lovely wife would make good food for Einstein, and they would discuss. He was a sounding board, and the one on the right picture, Besso, when he was very, both of them are old, But at that they were very young and they would be talking to each other. So when he started thinking, Einstein, thinking about electromagnetic theory, the problems I pointed out, then he started thinking of a new relativity theory. And he says, as he thought about it, it became a psychic tension growing all the time. But he wanted to give a theory which was all-encompassing, like thermodynamics. So I was thinking about it, and at that time, he was also reading this book, A Treatise of Human Nature by the philosopher David Hume. So that is not a physics book, but it was about human nature. But Hume talked about the psychological time that can change. Depending upon the state of mind of each person, your own perception of time can change. So Einstein thought, if time can change from person to person psychologically, why cannot it change from person to person, from observer to observer, in the physical time? So once again, I'm sorry, maybe I should keep it right here. No, on the other hand, it will fall down. That would be a disaster. So when he did that, he says, it came to me that time was suspect. So when he read Hume, he said, it came to me that time was suspect. So he thought maybe that time was the crux of the matter, and he took a walk to Bessos in May 1905, and then he had a long discussion, a day-long discussion with Besso, and realized that the time also has to change between inertial observers, and that did the trick. So he formulated his theory of relativity, and within 6 weeks he had published the paper. Now here is a cartoon drawn by Gujar, our very gifted cartoonist. Here is Einstein in the patent office, and there is a very cautious and the officer who is looking to make sure he is working well. So during the morning he would finish off all the patent applications, and in the afternoon he would be working on all these fantastic things like photoelectric effect, and then Brownian motion, and finally theory of relativity. So since he was an expert on patent applications, much later in his life, he and the chemist Leo Szilard took a patent on refrigerator. They took a patent on refrigerator compressor, but as it turned out, better compressors came into being, and poor Einstein could not sell his refrigerator. Otherwise, he would have become even richer than he was. But on the other hand, he did these papers, Brownian motion, photoelectric effect, and finally relativity. All this is in 1905. Which is known as the miracle year of Einstein, Annus Mirabilis. This is what was called Newton's miracle year in 1666, when he gave, you know, the laws of motion, calculus, and then gravitation, and so on and so forth. That is what he did. So we are going to talk about this briefly. This is the title of the paper, on the electrodynamics of moving bodies, and it has just two postulates: invariance of physical laws among inertial observers. If you have observers moving with constant velocity, the laws of physics will have to remain the same. In the next one, the constancy of light with respect to these observers. Whatever the observer's state of motion, velocity or standing still, you should measure the same constant velocity of light, and with this, he develops the entire theory of relativity, one after another, and he derived these what are known as Lorentz transformations. No, before that, let me come to that. Right in the beginning, he throws away, banishes ether. There is no ether. And next he talks about the simultaneity. He talks about a rod and time and all that. But here is a modern example. There is a train, and if you are going in the compartment, right in the middle there is a bulb which flashes light. So what happens? Light hits both the front and the back exactly at the same time, right? But on the other hand, if you are observing this from the platform sitting there, light has to take more time to hit the front and less time to hit the back. So therefore, the hitting of light at A and B are not simultaneous. So this was a very profound idea, because from that Einstein could think of time being different for both observers. So, as a result came these Lorentz transformations. Is it okay if I sit down and talk? That will be easier for me. No, I mean, do this. It will change, right? Ah, okay. So from a state of motion, I have moved to a state of rest. Okay, let me move so that you can. You don't have to see me. You have to see the slides. I hope. Also, the function of x, where space and time are mixed together. These transformations had been already derived by Lorentz, but he was trying to retain ether and do this. But on the other hand, Einstein, without ether, without anything, did all this, and with these transformations, he were invariant. That was not true with Galilean transformations. But the most important thing was, now Maxwell's equations were also invariant, and space-time, but both were combined, they came into being. So as you can see, space, which is through the distance, and time, which you measure with clocks, are both inextricably combined. But if Einstein were to come to Bangalore, space measured by distances according to roads have no correlation with time measured by traffic jams. Fortunately, Einstein did not come, But if he had come, there would have not have been so much traffic at all, and he would have been happy. So this is what happened. And he also applied this to optics, derived Doppler effect, relativistic Doppler effect. I can't see some of the people there, they can't see me. So I have moved here. Now, and also relativistic aberration and so on and so forth. And also certain other things which had never been even thought of, which is, for example, the length contraction. L, as seen from a rest observer, this L is that of the moving observer, would be contracted. And here is an example from George Gamow's delightful book, Tompkins in Wonderland, where Tompkins, who is at the center, is watching somebody going on a bike. So the person, the bike, everything looks contracted because of the length contraction. Similarly, if Tompkins himself is going on a bike, the whole city would look contracted. And here is another picture. Here it is. So Einstein's face at V equal to 0 is like that. 60% of C, so becomes, for 99% becomes very thin. Now the question, is this what you see if somebody is moving? Of course, you will have to be moving with great velocity. Apart from that, this is not what you are going to see, because this is known as Tyrrell effect. See, if I want to see the moving face, the light from left side and the right side, I have to come and hit my eyes at the same time, which means light from the left side would have started earlier and light from the right side would start later on. Because of this effect, the face will not look contracted but rotated. This is a very unusual effect known as Tyrrell effect, because Tyrrell was the one who realized this. So unfortunately, Tompkins in Wonderland doesn't work. Rotation will work. Similarly, he also derived time dilation. Time goes slow. Now, this is the equation, as you can see. 1 minus v squared by c squared, time will be elongated and it goes slow. And here is a cartoon. So here is Einstein's wife Elsa, all dressed up, probably waiting to go to a party. And Einstein comes late and he says, "Elsa, my dear, please try to understand. I ran fast, the watch ran slow, so I am late." So the faster you run, the slower you come. The students can give the same excuse to the teachers. But remember, to do this, you will have to be moving very fast, with a fraction of the speed of light. There is a story, apocryphal, I don't think it is true. It is said that Michelson once was driving a car. So he jumped the signal. When it turned red, he did not stop. He went, policeman stopped him, took him to a magistrate. He said, "Your Lordship, he crossed a red light, so has to be fined." Michelson, in his own defense, said, "Your Lordship, I was moving towards the red sign, and because of Doppler shift, I saw it green. So I went down." Now, the magistrate knew some physics. He said, "If red light has to be seen as green, you must have been going at a speed nearly that of light. So I won't give you a ticket I won't fine you for crossing red light. I will fine you for speeding. Okay? And this is a story. Okay. But this has effect. For example, the time dilation, which has been verified actually, experimentally. And the other one is increase of mass with velocity. Einstein also, you know, all this is in this paper of relativity of 1905. The mathematics is only high school mathematics. High school mathematics you can read. And hopefully even college and PhD students will also understand. High school students will definitely understand. So I hope everybody understands and do read it. I think it must be made compulsory reading, study of that paper. And here is the, that is m naught by 1 minus v squared by c squared. So if you increase the velocity, the mass will go up. The kinetic energy goes up, the mass will go up, and velocity of the observer v goes nearer and nearer c, the mass zooms up, and finally it becomes infinite if v becomes c. What does it mean? A person or any material particle cannot reach the velocity of light. What was the paradox? At the age of 16, if you move with the velocity of light, certain things will happen which cannot happen in nature. Therefore, this proves that you can never ever move as fast as light. So, here is Einstein trying to catch a wavefront moving with constant velocity of light, c, and he cannot do that. So the paradox of age 16 after 10 years was completely solved because of Einstein's relativity. It's a fantastic story. And then, oh, I forgot about this. Now this is an animation that was created by Gujar once again for the program we made on Einstein. Maybe it can be brought back to commemorate the centenary celebration. Let me show you. So this is going to illustrate all three effects. The ruler becoming shorter, time going slower, and mass increasing. Watch and enjoy. I don't have to explain. Okay. It's foreshortened. Now it shows the time. (clears throat) 78 kg overweight. He is also 78, I think. But he thinks it's 151 kg. Okay? So running faster does not reduce anybody. The weight will go up. So don't jog. Very dangerous. Now, Einstein's fourth paper, again in the same year, 1905, again, 2 pages long paper. What he did was, there was, he considered the electromagnetic radiation coming out of some system, maybe charges and so on. He calculated the change in the mass of this system, and then he calculated the radiation energy going out and showed that the energy radiated divided by c squared will be exactly equal to the mass change. So the change of mass is equal to the radiated energy divided by c squared. So then he wrote to his friend Konrad Habicht, his friend of years before in Berlin, stating, but for all I know, God Almighty might be laughing at the whole matter and might have been leading me around by the nose. That's what he said. The title of the paper is, Does the Inertia of Body Depend on this Energy Content? Here is the quotation which I read in one word. And by 1907, with his great insight, he generalized the whole thing into the most famous equation of all time. This is one equation I think everybody knows. What is it? Wonderful, E equal to MC. So was it God Almighty who was leading him by the nose, or the fallen angel of Almighty, namely the devil, because as we know what happened there. It gave rise to bomb, but on the other hand, it also brought the boon of nuclear energy and also showed how energy is produced in the center of our own sun or the stars, nuclear energy. And so the entire special relativity, N equal to mc squared, has actually revolutionized physics. Elementary particle physics, as Professor Lokanathar, a guru to all the REAP students, who started the REAP along with Professor Bala Iyer, so we owe it to him, here he is. He can tell you, relativity is indispensable to elementary particle physics, even astrophysics. For example, the Chandrasekhar limit, which we will be talking some time about, uses special theory of relativity. So it's encompassing everything. So that is special theory of relativity, and from which general theory of relativity came. So Einstein said, if God had been satisfied with inertial frames, he would not have created gravitation. Because he was talking in special theory of relativity, only constant velocity. But you know there is acceleration, which is related to gravitation. The two are interconnected. Therefore, Einstein says, one has to think of acceleration, one has to think of gravitation. And so as a result, after 10 years from special relativity, from the paradox to relativity, 10 years. From special relativity to general theory of relativity, another 10 years. So general theory of relativity came into being. And J.J. Thompson, the discoverer, said, this is the most important result obtained in connection with the theory of gravitation. It is one of the highest achievements of human thought. Perhaps the highest achievement of human thought. That's what we will be talking about in the next two lectures. Now, all along we have been talking about motion. For example, special theory of relativity has motion with constant velocity, and the general theory of relativity, gravitation, accelerated motion. So everything is related to motion, and Einstein himself had something wonderful to say about motion. Here is Einstein, says, life is like riding a bicycle. To keep your balance, you must keep moving. That's what he wrote to his son Edward. We will move on to general theory of relativity. And so we will move on from here. I hope you will keep your balance by moving around as on a bicycle. So we will meet next time. Thank you very much indeed.
before we take up some questions from the audience, we will have the customary vote of thanks. First of all, we would like to thank Albert Einstein himself for coming up with this phenomenal idea of general theory of relativity exactly 100 years ago, because of which we have assembled here today exactly 100 years later. So we thank next Professor C.V. Vishveshwara for introducing special theory of relativity to us in a very simple, but most importantly, without losing the essence of the subject. So thank you very much, sir. And this is the first time that we have gone on live streaming, a new venture into the cyberspace. And we thank the family, both metaphorically and literally, the Video Hut Productions, for making this first foray into cyberspace a very successful one. We thank them. And lastly, we would like to thank all of you who have come in very good numbers and made it a very memorable program. And we hope, like Professor Vishveshwara ended on a very optimistic note, that we will not only move on from here, but we will reassemble again next for the next lecture, which will be on the second Sunday of February.
No. Third Sunday.
Next.
Next one, because of my own...